Okay, this zakah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, there is zakah wajib, which is must, as Allah azza wa jalla said, innama sadaqatu lil fuqara wal masakin. At the end of the ayah, which is in Surah At-Tawbah, verse number 60. This mention the obligatory zakah, and we already discussed. Zakat al-tatawwa' or optional charity, it's not must. But the Muslim give away some of his wealth or his money or different types of help as an optional, and this is highly rewarded. And this, subhanAllah, it is from the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal that whenever there is obligatory act of ibadah, Allah Azza wa Jal bless us with optional types of the same the ibadah. Like, for example, when we pray, we have five prayers which are must, obligatory. But also, we were recommended, it was opened the door gates for us to do more of nawafil. That's mean optional prayers like sunan, like sunat, which is like sunan al-ratiba, or any types of sunnah or optional prayer, night prayer. It is from the same nature. It is prayer, but it's not must. And you remember before we said that this nawafil, this optional prayer, in fact, it will be very helpful for the believer at the day of judgment. Why? Because at that day, everybody will be questioned about his salah. If there's any deficit in salah, in his salah, and in some of the shortcoming, then it is by the blessing of Allah, if he has more of this nawafil, it will cover any deficit in his obligatory salah. Because it's mentioned in the hadith that Allah Azza wa Jal will ask, will tell the angels, look at the optional prayer of my slave or my servant and cover whatever there is any missing or any shortcoming in his obligatory salah. The same thing, subhanAllah, for zakah. We have obligatory zakah, but also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourage us to give as optional charity. The same thing like Hajj, like fasting. We fast only 1 month, which is Ramadan obligatory, but also it is recommended to have more of optional tatawwa. This is nawafid. This is called tatawwa, option, voluntary. It's not must. And my dear brothers and sisters, some people, you know, they said, well, this is sunnah or this is just tatawwa. And they are underestimate, you know, the value and the great reward of this voluntarily act of ibadah. While, you know, one hasana, in fact, just only one hasana, it is of great value, especially at the day of judgment, every person look and search for even one hasana. Okay, let's go now to this point. So the Imam al-Nawawi, he started this by the hadith, and this hadith, he mentioned only one part, which is relate for what? For the zakah, which is related to the chapter that we are studying. But the full hadith, in fact, as it was narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there are seven whom Allah will shade on the day when there is no shade but his. They are, and now he count those seven, they are a just ruler, a youth who grow up with worshiping Allah, one whose heart is attached to the masajid, two who loves each other, meet each other, and depart from each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A man who is tempted by a beautiful or beautiful woman of high status, but he rejects her saying, I fear Allah. And one spends in charity and conceal it such that his right hand doesn't know what his left hand has given. And one who remembered Allah in private and he wept. So these are the seven which were mentioned in the hadith. As we mentioned here, this Imam Nawawi mentioned only the part which is related to our subject. طيب. Now let's go to this hadith very quickly. The first one is, the just ruler. He said the first, they are just ruler. So what does it mean by just ruler? The just ruler is the one who governor or ruler or president or whoever, the sultan, that he rule justly, and that by what? By applying the rule which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this one, he will be one of those that he will be under the shade of Allah Azza wa Jal. Why? Because he is just, because he fear nobody if he wasn't just. But he fear Allah Azza wa Jal. This is why he tried to be just. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Azza wa Jal reward him by this great reward. So, and our beloved Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the most and the best known just ruler during his time. And this why, the all time in fact, and just imagine when he said, or remember when he said, if Fatima bint Muhammad steal, I will cut her hand. That's mean I will apply the rule of Allah even in my own beloved daughter. This to show you how just he was. And this is a good example for every Muslim ruler. The second one of those seven, he said, youths who grew up with worship in Allah. We know that the youth always are motivated by desire. They want to enjoy their time. They are strong muscles. They try to enjoy their time. So there's one who, even he is youth, he is strong, and he has the chance to play. But in fact, he care so much about worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the correct way. Because many of the youth, unfortunately, except those that Allah azza wa jal protect, they may miss their prayers. They may don't do their duties toward their parents, to their family. They are just caring about, enjoyment of themselves. This is why the one who's doing this, in fact, he's struggling. He is struggling to keep and doing the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his life. This is why he was giving this honor to be shade, to be under the shade of Allah at the day of judgment. The third one is one whose heart is attached to the masjid, the masajid, to the mosques. A person always he think about salah. Whenever he finish any salah, he is looking forward to the next salah. That means his heart always thinking about doing this great prayer. And this to show you, my dear brother, the importance of Salat al-Jama'ah. طيب. And the next one is two people, either brothers or sisters, who love each other, meet each other. That's mean that when they meet, until they left each other, and they love both, I mean, they love each other for the sake of Allah. Not because they are their relatives, not because they have money, not because, they have some business to do with. No, they all what attract them to each other is the fear of Allah and to the love of Allah. And this is the greatest type of friendship. Why? Because it's sincerely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And for sure, those people who were gathered under the love of Allah, for sure they will remind each other of the rights of Allah and doing their ibadah, and then they will give or exchange advice to each other. So the fifth of this group, a man who is tempted by a beautiful woman, a young man. And this woman, not only beautiful, but also of high status. But he is fearing Allah. He said, he rejected that offer. And he said, I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a good example for us that Allah Azza wa Jal told us about is the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. He was a slave in the palace of the ruler or the king at that place. And that woman, she was, you know, his master, and she was beautiful, she was young, and with all this, she closed all the doors and she said, come to me. And what he said, I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this to show you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he gave us these stories in the Quran, as we said before, it is true story, but also as lessons for everyone, for us to learn from. So this one who fighted against his own desire, especially she's strong with the young, and this woman is, is a higher place, a boss, for example, or she is beautiful, or she's wealthy, and he rejected all this temptation. Why? Because he feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the sixth, the one who spend the charity, and this is our topic here, and conceal it to the point that his right hand, he give with his right hand, trying his best that the left hand doesn't know what he's doing with the right hand. And this is, to show you that how much he try to conceal what he give away for the poor, for the needy. So he will, like he's thinking or believing, oh Allah, this is just a secret between me and you, my Lord. So only you, oh Allah, that you know it. And this to show you what, this is the real meaning of sincerity. Is it recommended always to conceal sadaqah? This depends. This depends for sure. It is better to not, to show it, to be sincerely for the sake of Allah. But in case of showing or giving this sadaqah in front of other for some benefit, like to encourage other, like for example, if there's donation or collecting or what they call it, fundraising for any charitable purposes, like poor, helping poor or masjid, or, and then they announce this, and then came a person and he give in front of the people, not because he want to show off, but to encourage them. This is also recommended. Why? Because he did it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. But, and he is sincere from his heart, but this to encourage people to do this. And the last one is one who remember Allah in private, alone. Nobody seeing him. Either he reciting the Quran or remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember the attribute of Allah, the meeting of Allah when we leave this world. And then he remember all this and then he cry, he weep, emotional. Why? Because his heart was full of the love of Allah Azza wa Jal and the name of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then this to show you real sincerity. Those seven people that Allah Azza wa Jal will shade them under his shade at that day. At that day, my dear brothers and sisters, there's, the ground will be flat. All people, just imagine billion of people from the time of Adam alayhi salam till the last man who lived in this earth, all of them, they gather at one time in flat land. That means no mountain, no hills, no cave, no stones, nothing, flat. And the sun come very close, as mentioned in the hadith. That's come as a mile, they said meal, and there are different explanations for this. And people, they will go in, it's in very heat of the sun. And then more than this, people will sink, their sweater because of that heat. Just imagine, what does the person need at that day? He need a shade. And this is wise, this is one of the greatest reward. And there's no Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shed us all at that day under Naam. So these, my dear brothers, are explanation for this hadith, which mentioned about the importance of hiding or hiding the zakah. Naam. Now let's go to the next hadith, brother. Naam, every.
Uqbah Ibn Amir, radiallahu anhu, narrated, I heard the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, say, everybody will be shaded by the Sadaqah on the day of judgment until he has been judged between the people, related by Ibn Hibban.
Nah, and so this, mashallah, this is also another example. We talk about the seven, but here's another thing. You give sadaqah, you will be under the shade of sadaqah. The one who reciting the Quran also, the one who rising Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran, as it was mentioned in some of the hadith, that in the day of judgment, they, Surah Ali Imran, Al-Baqarah, wa Surah Ali Imran, they will come, as you said, yamamatan or ghamamatan. That means they come like birds. And they give shade for the one who memorize it, the one who work with it. So the one also who read the Quran, who love the Quran, he will be shaded. So there are many ways that Allah Azza wa Jal reward people, depends on what they are doing. Naam. The next one, brother, any Muslim?
Naam. Abu Sa'id AI-Khudri, radiallahu anhu, narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, any Muslim who clothed another Muslim who is naked, Allah will clothe him from the green garments of paradise. Any Muslim who feed a Muslim who is hungry, Allah will feed him from the fruit of paradise. And any Muslim who gives drink to a Muslim who is thirsty, Allah will give him drink from the sealed nectar. Narrated by Abu Dawud with a weak chain of narrator.
Right. Anyway, even this shade, I mean, this narration is weak, as it said, but there are many other authentic hadiths which supporting this. And as they said, al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. Al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. That means the reward it will be from the same type of the act that you are doing. So you are giving a person who is in need for food, hungry, at the day of judgment, Allah Azza wa Jalla will feed you when you are hungry at that day. You are, in this time, you find a people who are a person who's thirsty, is need for water, and you give him the same thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you. So as it's mentioned, I think that the hadith is very clear. If you give clothes for a person who are in need to cover his body, like, you know, nowadays, as you know, nowadays, especially in this winter, and this very, very cold weather, there are many of our brothers and sisters who are in camp in many countries, many places, who are in need for some clothes to keep them, keep their children. And alhamdulillah, there are some official organization or official center that they can receive this, you can help through them. So the Muslim have many ways to get more of the good deeds in this world, and it will not be lost, because at the day of judgment, he will find all this great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This next hadith, brother.
Hakim bin Hizam radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the upper hand is better than the lower hand. For example, he who gives the charity is better than who he takes it. One good given by giving to his dependent, and the best sadaqah charity is that which is given by a wealthy person, who from the money which is left over after his expenses, and whoever abstain from the asking others from some financial help, Allah will provide for him and save him from asking others. Allah will make him self-sufficient. Agreed upon. And this version is of Al-Bukhari.
Right. This hadith agreed upon. That means it was reported by Al-Imam Al-Bukhari and Al-Imam Muslim. But this version is the one that was mentioned in the book of Al-Imam Al-Bukhari. Hakim ibn Huzam, as he said here, Al-Yad Al-Ulya Khayrun Min Al-Yad Al-Sufla. The upper hand is better than the lower hand. What is the upper hand? The upper hand who give, and the lower hand who take. So this is when you give, you know, you give money or something. So this is the upper hand, the one who give, and the lower hand is the one which take. So this to show you that the one who is giving is for sure better than the one who receive. Especially if the one who receive, in fact, he is not in, entitled for this sadaqah. Somebody who doesn't deserve it. And then the hadith said, وَابْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُولْ. Then you should start with what? Start with the one who depend on you. That means if you have sadaqah, you have money, you want to give charity. So some people, they think if you give it to somebody outside, they don't know, they think this is more greater. While if you give it, if you're dependent in need for it, then it's better to be spend it in this way. This is what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If your family is in need, it's not right to go and spend money and give charity to everyone while your family in need. Will you get reward for this? For sure. For sure, you will get reward for this as you make charity. In fact, as it said here, that you start with the one that you depend on you, which means it's more bitter to give charity or give charity to somebody who depend on you. And this is also because it is must on the person to spend on his family. The same thing also, first of all, we start with what? We start with what is whatever must, as it's mentioned here in this hadith, as it said here in this hadith. So some people, for example, they give sadaqah while they are in debt. So if the person in debt and people are waiting for him to give them their money, first of all, you should pay your debt and then you can give sadaqat, because this is must while you are, you are in debt, you should give it to them before you think about giving sadaqah. And then he said, وَمَنْ يَسْتَعْفِفْ رَفُّهُ اللَّهِ. وَمَنْ يَسْتَعْفِفْ, the one who try to be sufficient, self-dependent. He doesn't depend on people to receive sadaqah. He said, يُعِفُّهُ اللَّهِ, that's Allah Azza wa Jal will provide. So if you truly depend on Allah, sincerely on Allah, Allah will give you. And this is why, my dear brothers, as we said before, that Islam teach the Muslim always to be honored by what? By link his heart and put his in need in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not look for what people are giving him or wait for any help from people, especially if he go more than this and he ask. Like those beggars, they go around, you find them after outside the masajid, on the street, in the market. Many of these people, in fact, are liars. Many of them, they are not in need. So, but there are some who are in need, truly. But we said that if the person, he tried to stay away from asking people, Allah Azza wa Jal will provide him. وَمَنْ يَسْتَغْنِي يُغْنِهِ اللَّهِ. That means whoever feel that he's sufficient with whatever Allah give him, even it is a little, Allah Azza wa Jal will bless, Allah Azza wa Jal will bless whatever he has, and then he will not be in need for the people. So here, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he mentioned two types of people. The poor who doesn't ask people because he only want to turn to Allah Azza wa Jal. Muta'affif. This one, in fact, he was honored here. That Allah Azza wa Jal will help him to be self-dependent and he will not in need for it. The other type are rich. He is rich. That means he is rich, but he give away. And he give away and doesn't keep it. You know, because unfortunately, you know, that there are some people who are rich. They have a lot of money, subhanAllah, but they live, you know, the life of the poor. If you look at one of them, maybe you will go and give him sadaqah, give him money. And you look at his clothes, you look at his life as his children, you see these people are poor family. And then when this man die, you know, subhanAllah, his family, they find in the bank maybe millions in his account. So this person, in fact, even he lived this life as a poor while Allah Azza wa Jal blessed him with all this money. So the Muslim should always show whatever khair or gift Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gifted him. طيب, let's go to the next hadith. Abu Hurairah, go ahead, brother.
Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, which kind of sadaqah is better? He replied, that which is given by the one who does not have much property and given by giving to your dependent, related by Ahmad and Abu Dawud, Ibn Uzaymah, Ibn Hibban and Al-Hakim rated it as
Al-Hakim, Al-Hakim rated as sahih. Okay, so this is another hadith which also support what we said before. It said, when one asks the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the best type of sadaqah? He said, jahdul muqil. That means what? Which kind of sadaqah? He said, that which is given by one who doesn't have much. That means he's something who has a little, but he give. This person is better than the rich one who give, especially if he give more. Let's just an example. If there is a person who has all his wealth, only, let's say, 1,000 riyal, and he give away from this 1,500, while there are another one who have million riyal, and he have only give 500, which one is better? In fact, this one, why? Because he give 50%. Of his wealth, whatever he has, while the other one, it doesn't mean anything, you know, in percentage in what he has. So this is the meaning of this hadith. And then the next advice, and begin by giving to your dependents. It also support and strength what we just previously explained, that a person or the Muslim should start with, taking care of his family and his dependents. Now, let's go to this hadith. It's interesting hadith. Now,
Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, give sadaqah. Aman then said, Allah's messenger, I have a dinar. He then said to him, give it to yourself as sadaqah. The man again said, I have another one. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, give it to your children as sadaqah. He said, I have another one. He said, give it to your wife as sadaqah. The man again said, I have another one. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, give it to your servant as sadaqah. He said, I have another one. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, you know better to whom you should give it. Related by Abu Dawud and Ibn Hibban and Al-Hakim regarded it as sahih.
طيب, this hadith, explain or give us more detail about the order of the best sadaqah that a person spent. So this man, he came to the Prophet ﷺ. So he hear the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said, give sadaqah. I mean, he encouraged people to give charity. So a man, he came and he said, oh, Prophet of Allah, I have one dinar, like $1 or $1 or 1 rupiah. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, said, spend it on yourself. So first of all, take yourself, care of yourself. And he said, this is sadaqah for you. So when the Muslim spend on himself to keep himself, he is not in need for other, this will be count for him as sadaqah, as charity. This is a blessing from Allah. You spend in yourself and it will be counted for you as good and good deed. Why? Because you didn't spend it in something which is unlawful. You spend it in something lawful and you are more in need. And the second one, he said, I have another one. So he said what? He said, spend it on your wife. This is also depend on you. And in other hadith we mentioned before, وَاللُّقْمَةُ تَضَعَهَا فِي فَمِ زَوْجَتِكَ صَدَقَ. That's even the piece of food that you put it in the mouth of your wife. That's when you buy food for your wife. This will be considered as a charity. And then he said, I have another one. So this is the order that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, wife, and then your children, and then your relative, and then if you have some neighbor, and then if you have more, then you can give it to whom that you wish. طيب, and this, there's another hadith which is very close to this and confirm that spending on family is highly rewarded than just giving somebody who away. Look at this here, the hadith which is reported by Aisha radiallahu anha. Naam, Aisha.
Aisha anha narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when a woman gives some of the foodstuff which she has in her house in charity without being extravagant, without being wasteful, she will receive the reward of what she has spent, and her husband will receive the reward because of his earning, and the keeper, if any, will be similarly rewarded. The reward of the one will not decrease, the reward of the others agreed upon.
Subhanallah. This is, look at this hadith. When a woman, she give any food, sometimes we have some food we eat, and then sometimes we have more food than what we need. Some people, they just throw it in the trash. That's wrong. So if you have something extra food that you don't need, look around you. If you find, especially here, you have many of those workers, those laborers, those drivers who are far away from their family. They are will be feel very happy, when you, if you know any of them, and you have enough food after you eat your lunch or dinner with your family, and they're, mashallah, nice, good food, and you go and give it to them. Now, if the woman, the lady that she send it, for example, to anybody who is in need, she is rewarded. And also the husband will get reward because he's the one who earned it. And if they have like in a palace or in a place, there's somebody who are keeping this also. Three people are rewarded for one action, and none of them will take from the reward of the other. And this to show you the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this hadith, Abu Sa'id.
Abu Sa'id radiallahu anhu narrated, Zainab, the wife of Ibn Mas'ud, came along and said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, you have commanded us today to give Sadaqah, charity. I have some jewelry of mine and I wanted to give it as a Sadaqah. But Ibn Mas'ud claimed that he and his children are the most entitled to my Sadaqah, deserve it more than anyone else. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Ibn Mas'ud is right. Your husband and your children are more deserving, related by Al-Bukhari.
MashaAllah. This is also confirmed previous hadith when we said the Muslim should start for his dependent. For example, if the woman is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her, she's wealthy. Let's say, for example, she inherited from her father, brother, somebody, some money. This is her money. Be careful about this. And this is one of the things that you will not find it in some communities. In Islam, if the woman has money that's belong to her, no one has the authority to spend it or take it from her, even her husband. Maybe the woman is wealthy because she got some inheritance, or she had made business before, or she is working like a doctor, a nurse, teacher, or whatever, and she's earning better than her husband. Her husband has no right to take one rial, one penny, without her permission. This is her money. He should spend in the family. But in this hadith, to show us, if the family is in need, it's not must on the woman to spend in the family. We know that the one who should spend in the family is the husband. But if the family is in need, and then she give her husband or her children from this, then this will be considered as charity fund. That even if the husband in debt and the woman is wealthy and she want to give away zakah, also it is okay to give her zakah to her husband to pay his debt. Why? Because people in debt are entitled for zakah. And then he is better to get it than, you know, to give it to somebody else. So this is to show you this hadith. So when this woman, she was surprised, Ibn Mas'ud, he was poor, and he said, we are more entitled, we are in need. She said, well, I'll go to ask the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when she came and asked the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told her what? Ibn Mas'ud was telling the truth, and he's right. Then he shouldn't spend it on their na'am. The next hadith, brother.
Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, a man who persists in begging people to give him charity will come on the day of judgment and there will not be a piece of flesh on his face. Agreed upon.
Yes. This hadith, in fact, is a very clear warning for those who go and beg without need. You know, as we said, there are some people, they collect money, they took begging people as a business. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this, he said, at the day of judgment, those people who are begging without need, they will come and there's in their face, there's no flesh, just bones, to show that these people, they waste their honor during their life just to collecting money while they are not in need. Na'am. And the next one, Abu Hurairah.
Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "He who asks others to give to him in order to increase his own wealth is akin to one who asks for live coals. He who wishes to have more, let him have it, and he who wishes to have less, let him have it." Related by Muslim.
Another warning. The one who gets money that he is not in need is like a person who is collecting coals. And you know how much it's hot. So the Prophet ﷺ said, it depends on you. You want more coals the day of judgment, more fire in your hand. You get more of this money that you are not you don't need from people. Now, the next one, brother. Zubair.
As-Subair bin Al-Awwam radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, it is better for any of you to take a rope and cut some wood from the forest and carry it over his back and sell it to preserve his dignity as he is earning his own living rather than ask a person for something and that person may give him or not, related by Al-Bukhari.
This is my dear brothers, to show you that the Muslim should work for his earning and don't depend on other. He should keep and preserve his dignity and his honor. So he's not in need. That even if he work in something which is tough, like going to collect wood and sell it. And there is one hadith which was mentioned that one man, he came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he said, oh Prophet of Allah, I'm in need. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasalam looked at him and he found him is young, strong man. So he told him, do you have anything at home? He said, I have some like a dish, or like a cover, you know, that's something that I sleep on. So the Prophet alayhi wasalam told him, okay, go get it. And when he brought it to the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, who will buy these things? And so one of the Sahaba, he bought it, he paid 2 dinar for it, 2. So he gave him 1 dirham, he said, this, take it and spend it in your family. Buy food for yourself. And for this, go and give me ox, something that, you know, they use to cut woods. So he brought it to the Messenger of Allah alayhi wasalam, and the Prophet, he put wood to hold this ox and told him, go to the desert, go outside and cut off this wood and sell and come to me in a few days. Later on, a few days, he came with, he has more money. So the Prophet told him, isn't this better that you are working and you are making your own earning than just go and ask people? They may give you and they may not. This also to show you, my dear brothers, when the person, in fact, is working, whatever your job is, if you are doing your work and you have the intention sincerely for Allah Azza wa Jal, that you want to protect yourself, to depend on yourself, to provide for your family, to care about your children, and you are not in need for people, every minute that you spend in your work with this intention, it's like you are doing good deeds. And you will be rewarded for this. Why? Because you are trying your best to do your obligation, which Allah Azza wa Jal commanded you toward your family, you know, by working hard for this. So it is to show you the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The last chapter, which is division of zakah, and here we are talking about who are the people, because, you know, now we already discussed that it's not right for a person to ask people to give him. It is not right for the Muslim to depend on others. But in Islam, there mention certain group of people that they are entitled to receive the zakah, that it's okay for them, you know, that we can help them. And this, as you know, it was mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah. Let's go through all this hadith, and then we'll go to discuss all this group very quickly to finish this chapter, inshallah. Go, brother, with Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. Naam.
Abu Sa'id al-Khudri narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, zakah is not allowed for the well-off person except for one of the following five: an administrator of zakah, a man who buys zakah holdings with his money, a person who is in debt, a fighter in the cause of Allah, or a rich person who is given a present by a needy, miskin person, which the latter had been given as a zakah, related by Ahmad, Abu Dawud, Ibn Majah, and Al-Hakim regard it as a sahih.
طيب, the next hadith also. نعم.
Abu Ubaydullah bin Adi bin Al-Khayyar narrated that the two men told him that they had gone to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking him to give them something from the zakah money. As he was distributing it at that time, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Look them up and down," and found them to be sturdy and strong. He then said to them, "If you desire, I shall give it to you. But this zakah is not for the one who is rich, neither for the one who is strong and able to earn." Related by Ahmad, Abu Dawud, and An-Nasi.
And then this one,
Qabisa bin Mukharij al-Hilali, radiallahu anhu, narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Asking for the money of zakah is justified only for the following three. First, a man who is in debt. It is then permissible for him to receive zakah until his difficulty is resolved. Second, a man who was struck by calamity which destroyed his holdings, which also makes it permissible for him to receive zakah until he is in a position to earn his own living. And third, a man who has been reduced by poverty and three persons of caliber from among his people testify to his desperate circumstances, which will receive until he finds a means of support for him, for himself. Other than these cases, Qabisa, it is considered as taking so unlawful or haram earnings, and the person receiving it, this zakah, will be consuming forbidden, unlawful holdings. Related by Muslim, Abu Dawud, Ibn Huzaima, and Ibn Hibban.
Now, this also another three types. Inshallah, at the end of the class, I will summarize those eight categories, inshallah, very clearly. Just go to finish with this hadith. The last two hadith, in fact, it's talk about, just to save time, this hadith, it say that it is not lawful, you know, to be or to given or to given the zakah for the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will not take of the zakah, and also for the family of Abdul Muttalib, the relative of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I think this we cover all this hadith which relate to this chapter. Now let's me very quickly explain the eight category which was mentioned here. Was mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, "Innama as-sadaqatu lil-fuqara'i wal-masakin wal-'amilin 'alayha wal-mu'allafati qulubuhum وفي الرقاب والغارمين وفي سبيل الله وابن السبيل والله عليم حكيم." Those are eight group of people who are entitled to receive the zakah. الصدقات, let's explain one by one now. The first one is الفقراء. Who is الفقير? Because sometimes people confuse between فقير and مسكين. Poor and needy. The ulama said that the faqir, that he doesn't have enough food for him and his family that cover at least 1 year. So they are in need. They don't have enough. And the one who has some but will not cover his need to the end of the year, this will be considered as miskin. So that means he has some, but it's not enough, not sufficient. And as you remember, you see if you Surah Al-Kahf, when we read in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the ship which was destroyed by Al-Khidr alayhi salam. What he said, أما السفينة فكانت لمساكين يعملون في البحر. The ship, it was owned by masakin. So even they have a ship and they work, but they still masakin, which means that the miskin is better in case than the poor. The miskin, the needy, he has something, he makes some earning maybe, but his earning doesn't cover his expenses. This is the miskin. And then والعاملون عليها, those who collecting the zakat, especially if the government doesn't give them salary, they are voluntarily, they go to collect the zakat. So those also, it is okay to spend and give them salary or something from this zakat. والمؤلفة قلوبهم, المؤلفة قلوبهم, this to attract their heart. And this either, for example, one that you feel that he will come to Islam, that his heart is soft and you want to help him to think, you know, more, look at to be considering to be a Muslim, but he's hesitating. If you give him maybe some gift or some money, and this will help him to get him more closer or help him, against the shaitan, this is mu'allafati qulubu. So this is the, and then al-riqab, what was called it, captive, either captive in the war that we, some captive that their kidnapper, they were kidnapped, and the kidnapper, they want money so they can free them. It is okay to give from the money of the zakah to free them. And then the one in debt. So the debt are of two types. Either debt for himself or debt for others. Now, what the difference between the person who is in debt for himself or the others? The one who is in debt for himself, a person that he was in need, for example, to fix his car, to pay tuition for his children, and then he gets some money, some loan, and he cannot spend it he cannot retain it because his earning, regular earning, will not cover his expenses. So how can he pay his debt? So anyone who in debt, then it is okay to give him from the zakah. The other type of people in debt, that he is not in debt for himself. Let's say he was trying to make some consolation between two people fighting. And then one of them, of these two people, they want some money from the other so he can resolve this dispute between them. So this man who want to settle this case, he got a loan from some people to help them and to settle this situation. And now he gets this loan, he became in debt, not for himself, but to make consolation for others. This one also, it is okay to give him from the zakat. Fi sabilillah, and this is the cause of Allah. And this including anything for the cause of Allah, including like, for example, paying for teachers in Islamic schools, paying for buying, publishing Islamic books for da'wah, for fighting for the cause of Allah, all this including in the fi sabilillah. And then ibn al-sabil is the one who is traveler, and he become in a situation that he lost his money, he has nothing, that he cannot return to his home. This person, this traveler, even he is rich in his town, in his country, but here is a stranger here and he has nothing to get him back. And there's no way to get money to ask, like, you know, these days, maybe somebody transfer for him through bank, through anything. But if there is no way that he get from his wealth there, he's in need, it's okay to give him from zakah enough money to help him to return back to his home. So this, inshallah, summarize everything, my dear brothers and sisters, about zakah and sadaqat. And by this, by the alhamdulillah, the grace and the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, we covered the book of zakah. And inshallah, next week we'll start the book of fasting, which, as I said, alhamdulillah, has come in the right time. So we'll be preparing, inshallah, for Ramadan from now by learning about fasting. So, because my dear brothers, it's very important to do your ibadah in the correct way. You should learn about this ibadah. And it is our chance to learn about fasting and Ramadan. May Allah Azza wa Jal reward you all and increase us all in the knowledge of the deen. طيب. So we stop here and if we'll leave some time for your question. If you have any question you want to ask, so please go ahead and ask now. Anybody have a question, you can raise his hand. Anyway, we still have the chance in case that you want to make any question, you can send it to the group and we can answer it, inshallah, in our next meeting. May Allah Azza wa Jal reward you all. Jazakallah khair, brother Abdul Malik, for the time that you read. And also, may Allah, jazakallah khair, all brothers and sisters, for your attendance. May Allah Azza wa Jal bless the knowledge that we share and we learn. And the most important matter, my dear brothers and sisters, is what? Is to practice what we learn and also to share what we learn. It is very important for the Muslim, whenever he learns anything, that he should pass it to other, to increase the knowledge of other Muslims. Barakallah feekum. See you inshallah next week. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.